Hello, anatomy friends. This is Dr. Alsup, and welcome to your second lab visit. And we are starting off with station number one. In this specific lab visit, we're going to focus on the appendages. So not only the bones, but also the joints and the muscles that will make up these fairly complex regions of the body. So station one, we are focusing on the bones of the pectoral girdle, which are the clavicle and the scapula. So you can see in this anterior view, here we go. Thought it was going to let me write, but here we go. So clavicle is this, we colloquially refer to as the collarbone, the strut-like bone right here, and the scapula. As you can see here, you can see a much better view of the scapula on a posterior view of the thoracic cage with a little bit shorter view of the clavicle here. So let's start with the clavicle first. The clavicle is going to have a shaft that has this kind of double curvature associated with it. And it will have two ends that I hope that you will be able to identify. The first is going to be the sternal or the medial end. And this is going to be the more enlarged end. It looks a little bit more bulbous to me. And it is going to articulate with the manubrium right here at the clavicular notch. And this forms the sternoclavicular joint. The acromial end, or the lateral end of the clavicle, is a bit more flattened or kind of tapered off in comparison to the more bulbous sternal end. And this is going to articulate with the acromion of the scapula. Now, looking at an individual scapula, this is going to be an anterior view. And this is going to be a posterior view. And the reason that I know this is posterior is always very easy for me to be able to identify because it has this very prominent spine that is going to be running along the more superior portion of the bone. So this is the spine of the scapula, and it will continue laterally and it will flatten and actually expand in terms of size as the acromion. And sometimes you hear this referred to as the acromion process, and this is what is articulating with that acromial end of the clavicle. Oops, excuse me. And you can even see a little bit of the acromion right here on this anterior view. What's clearer on the more anterior view, which you can only see a little bit of right here, is the coracoid process, which is supposedly kind of this beak-like shaped structure. It will be found superior to the glenoid cavity, which will be right here. We'll see a better view of that in a moment. And it's going to project anterolaterally. So I always think of this as like almost like a bent finger that is pointing toward the shoulder joint. And lots of things are going to attach here. You're going to have ligaments that are associated with both the shoulder joint and the acromioclavicular joint, as well as muscles like the pectoralis minor and the short head of the biceps brachii will have an attachment on this coracoid process. Now, looking at a lateral view of the scapula, the dominant structure here is the glenoid fossa. Sometimes you hear this referred to as the glenoid cavity. You'll hear it either way. Either one is correct. But this glenoid fossa is always facing laterally because it needs to articulate with the lateral humerus. And this is going to be the socket portion of that glenohumeral joint. So you can see how relatively shallow this area is in comparison to the head of the humerus, which is considerably larger, not allowing for a particularly great fit between the head of the humerus and the glenoid fossa. You can see a little bit of the coracoid process here and the acromion right here on the, as these are more superior structures. All right, so those are the main structures that I want you to be able to identify on the clavicle and the scapula. We are going to continue our tour, moving distally in terms of the bones of the upper limb. As you review, please make sure to, and always feel free to reach out with any questions early and often. Thanks for your time and attention here. Have a great day.